What's up, guys? Welcome back to Six Play Live TV. This is Six Play Now here, and today I'm gonna be making a tier list for all the characters in the game, and I'm gonna be venting a little bit, so you guys should watch out for that. But mostly, I'm gonna be trying to discuss these characters and try to do my best to pick the ones that are good. And show it to you guys, and also show the ones that you guys should avoid. Right, so I'm just gonna go from the top all the way back here. All right. Well, actually, let's start with it's just gonna be random. Let's start with the S tier. You know what? Let's just I shouldn't just go ahead and just start picking S tier's character. Let's just start with Alicia here. All right, Alicia, let's see. Alicia is a mage, and Alicia is a ranged DPS, and she got shields, she got CC, she got a huge AoE ultimate, and she got some decent poke from long distance. Strong peel, she can peel for her ally very easily. Called Escape. It's super nice, and I mean Alicia can jump from one side of the map to the other side pretty much. Like, her jump distance is insane. Some people use it, but they don't use it like to the full potential. But Alicia can really jump. Like, she can jump really far, and if you have like double jumps, that's crazy. So almost nobody can touch you. All right, so I think Alicia. And even if they can get close to you, right, you can just EX yourself and become immune to most damage until your shield is depletes pretty much. I'll put Alicia in S tier. She's a really strong character to have. She's like one of the strongest ranged character in the entire game to me, in my opinion. Not a lot of people know how to play her though, but honestly, Alicia, like, it's not that hard to learn Alicia. Like, what you gotta do is you gotta focus more on your positioning and when to use your EX. Alicia has strong EX abilities. Like, all of her EX abilities, I think all of them have values, right? If you need a build, just you can use like my old build for Alicia, with my in-depth god or whatever that I did earlier. Alicia is a really strong. I would recommend her to anybody. Yeah, we have Ashka. Now, Ashka is it's a ranged character too, and Ashka is burst DPS. Alicia is not burst. Alicia is more of a sustained DPS, and she got a whole lot of. She has the advantage in like setting up real burst comp. Right, she can set up pretty nice games, right? Anyways, on the other hand, Ashka, on the other hand, he's really good at setting up, but he's a very team dependent character. Alicia, you can jump off and do whatever you want and still jump back to your allies. However, Ashka is a bit of a team player, and if you're having Ashka, you need like a You need a strong melee, and you need a strong sense of positioning. Ashka EX, one of his EX is not that useful. Like, his EXE, I think, that kind of like stuns enemies near him. I don't think it's that useful, honestly. But there are so many other ways Ashka can do insane damage. Like, his basic attack does insane amount of damage. So Ashka, if you know how to play him, I think Ashka is an S tier for those who know how to play him. But if you don't know how to play him, you can really troll. You can troll your matches super easily. So I'm gonna put Ashka in A, just because it's not that easy to play him. But if you know how to play him, you can do pretty well. And he's also team dependent. So he's gonna be put in A because, like, in solo queue, In 3v3s, Ashkai is a decent character, right? He will fall like in a higher tier than this. But in solo queue, where you have to play with people you don't know and stuff like that, Ashkai will fall in A tier. In threes, Alicia shines. In solo queue, Alicia also shines. That's why she's in the S tier, because anyone can pick her up and learn her really fast. And sometimes you don't really your positioning really doesn't matter, because there's like a getaway free card with your EX. You can just time yourself out and just wait and heal yourself until your abilities cool down and stuff like that. As for Ashka, if people jump on him, if you don't have his space ability up or his E, even if he has the E up, if he has his E up, he can even like he can only E one person. Alicia can stun an entire she can crystallize an entire enemy team whatsoever, or she can just crystallize herself. So that's a lot more stronger in my opinion than the Ashka itself. So Ashka is gonna fall in A tier, and also a lot of people don't play Ashka as well. So he's not a fan favorite. I've seen a lot of Alessia in solo queues than Ashka's. So yeah. All right, now we're gonna go to Bako. Bako is an A tier pick. Don't get me wrong, Bako is super strong and you can get away with a lot. It's just that a lot of people who pick Bako don't know how to use them, and it's really annoying to have a bad Bako player. But Bako is a really strong character. I want to put him in S tier, but I'll keep him in A tier, because Bako is I don't know, he's not that hard to play, right? However, you have one escape ability and you have one ability that kind of like deflects attack and stuff like that. People usually build Bako wrong. They take the shield space on Bako, and the shield space is not that useful, because Bako is usually all the way in the enemy phase, and because it's like so hard to kill him due to his aura and like his self-sustain with the auto attack and stuff. A good Bako player can like solo two guys, right? 1v2. A bad Bako player won't last like 30 seconds into the match, because he would just waste all his cooldown and just die. I would just keep Bako in B tier, because not a lot of people know how to play him. I've seen a lot of Bako players in solo queue. No, I haven't seen a lot of Bako players in solo queue, but the ones that I've seen, they don't really know how to play him. And also, when Bako messes up, he's really vulnerable. It's quite easy to punish Bako if you have like a stealth character, or if you have like a CC like coming from up people like Shenrao, whatever his name is, and people like Ashka can punish Bako quite easily, because he has to like he gotta walk to you, and you can just drop stuff under him and just stun him and like take him out. Bako also, if your allies are being pressured, a good Bako player would know how to like defend his allies. He got in caps, he got stuns, he got slows, he got everything. Like Bako is really like all of these characters. I think Bako is really strong, but the only thing is that not a lot of people know how to play Bako. That's the only problem, bro. That's the only reason why Bako is here, because a lot of people pick Bako, but they build him in correctly. And so I mean, unless we see some really decent Bako player, Bako is gonna be A tier. Blossom is a pretty strong character. However, a lot of Blossom I've seen, usually they are divided into like two categories. There are Blossom that just focus on healing and do nothing else. They don't throw M1s, they don't really they don't really attack and stuff like that, right? They just heal, just heal bots. And then there are blossoms that just build full DPS build and just int until they die. And those one I like the I like curses. Blossom, I would say Blossom is an A tier too. She's a really strong character because of that shield. If you know how to pull your EX down. However, the shield, a lot of the time in solo queue, when you drop your shield, people don't stay in your shield. They just run away and just start doing their own stuff. And because of that, because like Blossom is like a team dependent character, and people kind of like take advantage of her, in a sense that they just make her want. They just assume that she's gonna continue to heal them forever, even though the strongest aspect of Blossom is the shield thing. And some healers don't really know how to use that EX shield, so I think that's why Blossom is gonna be A tier. We have your boy Croak. Croak got stealth, he got in caps, he got stun, he got blinds, and he got an insane amount of sustain. Like it's not hard to escape people's abilities. Croak can jump in, jump out. It's really hard to like kill Croak. Usually in matches, Croak is like the last person to die, and that's where the Croak memes come from. Where like you see Croak doing all the stylish stuff at the end of the match when all the allies are dead, and they actually spend the time trying to attack the enemies, but the enemy just have watered them all along. That's where that meme come from. But Croak is really really strong, and on his own he can 1v2 people, and in threes Croak also shines. The only problem here is Croak. He's kind of vulnerable, like Bako. He's kind of vulnerable to attacks that he really don't have control over. Stuff like attacks that are like CC, that they can be laid under the melee. Stuff like Ashka stuns and stuff like that. He's kind of vulnerable to those. Alessia CCs. He's kind of vulnerable to those. But like that's all. That's what all melees are vulnerable to, pretty much. And pretty much everybody is vulnerable to, apart from like God, Shifu or something, who can like become invulnerable at will. But you know, you can jump out of there, you can like, you know, slide out of it and all of that stuff. So I think Croak will go in S tier, because he can sustain himself on his own. He really don't need heals. A good Croak player can like pretty much carry his team, and the damage output is insane on Croak. He got so many utility stuff, spells, and like it's just too crazy. Croak is a really really strong character. And I mean, sometimes you don't see good Croak players, but just because like Croak is such a cool character, like so many people want to actually learn him, right? Like unlike most of these characters, Croak is like one of the characters that people just want to learn because he's like so cool to play as, and he's like so fun to play as, right? We have Destiny here. Destiny is a B tier. A good Destiny is able to like keep their allies supported while also doing insane damage off run. However, like I don't see any Destiny players these days. And the few Destiny's players that I've seen have usually lost their matches with me or against me. So I haven't seen a good Destiny carry pretty much. Anyways, you guys can like speak out on this, but you know, I think Destiny is a fun character to play, but she's not that strong, because I haven't seen people play her in a really, really decent way. Especially in solo queue. And I haven't seen any Destiny meme yet, right? Let's see. Oh, Destiny ult is also a bit garbage, honestly. You have to like ult with her like in a very tight space, in order to like get value out of it. Or you have to like really like, you have to like map that shit. Like you have to like do like real calculation and stuff, like geometry. You have to like know math and stuff to like activate this girl up and like get values out of it. So I think that's a little bit of a difficult thing to do. So it's not that easy to learn her, and that's why she's in the B tier. Izmo is a very, very strong character. However, a lot of people don't know how to play him. Even I don't know how to play him, and I've played Izmo like a lot, right? So that's that. So the problem with Izmo is that he has like two escape abilities, and once you use those, like you are quite vulnerable. Izmo is just a very, very tiny guy, and like people can just easily burst him down. And the only thing with Izmo players is that they are super fast and they are just annoying. If you know how to do those, you'll be pretty good with playing Izmo. Izmo EX abilities are super strong. Apart from the I think the EXM one, the ESM two, the EX shield is super strong. You can save your ally with that, and if you really play him right, like he can do insane amount of damage. But it's kind of like a snowball type of thing, right? You have to be stealing those orb, pulling it towards your ally and stealing it. You gotta be dropping your R abilities as soon as they show up, as soon as they pop up, so your allies and you can get some heals and stuff if you took that right. It's kind of hard to like to build Izmo because you have to like balance utility and DPS at the same times. And Izmo attack distance is not that far, honestly, compared to other characters. Izmo attack distance is a bit shorter, I think. So I'll put him in the B tier because not a lot of people know how to play Izmo properly. And Izmo, you'll be better off playing something else other than Izmo. His ultimate is kind of garbage, honestly. I mean, you're gonna have to like really combo that stuff with like somebody like Croak or Alessia, where like she drop her ice and like it frees people, and then you ult them so that they cannot move while your ult is about to get to activate. However, like Izmo, like when he put it all down, you can just walk out of it, honestly. You just gotta be around the edge, or you can just jump out of it and stuff like that. Most of these characters ult can be dodged. However, Izmo is his ult, like you really won't get value out of it unless you have like three of those guys like stuck in a corner and you like ult them and stuff like that. I mean, you'll be better off using something other than your ult as Izmo, honestly, because it takes a little bit longer to activate. And in that time, people can be waiting for that cooldown, and as soon as it's about to activate, it can just jump out of it. Right, so now we have Freya. Freya is a very strong character too. She's a melee. Honestly, like Freya is like Pearl. Nobody want to touch Freya, because if you touch her, like you might activate her counter. You might activate her counter, and she can like really mess you up. Nobody want to get close to Freya because she got coronavirus. Never mind. Anyways, Freya is a very, very strong character. However, there's this thing where like people try to avoid her a lot, and you have to like get in the face of people. You have to like just keep aggroing them, and like keep you have to be annoying like Izmo for them to actually want to hit you and stuff like that. And because of that, like sometimes you can activate your counter and nobody will want to touch, I mean nobody will touch it because like nobody was thinking about you in the first place. And you kind of need your counter to get hit, right? To get that shield so you can be able to do more damage. So it's kind of tough, right? Playing Freya. And it's really easy for you to like jump and get that movement speed and go crazy and just run into them. And as soon as you get there, like your allies are like all the way back in your spawn, and you actually end up in like a 1v3 situation and get, you get ass beat. However, Frieza is a really, really good character to play. I'll put her in B tier because not a lot of people play Frieza, because a lot of people know how to play Frieza. And if you mess up, it's really easy, especially in this meta. Like a lot of ranged characters, I mean, a lot of people are playing characters that can just they can just AFK damage. Like they can just brain dead characters. That's what people are playing. Like people are playing meta picks that are really, really strong, right? Your pick. I mean, people are playing this. Varish. People are playing Rheagon, and people are playing stuff like I don't see the Shenhe here. But anyway, people are playing Shenryu. So Shenryu, since he's not here, I'm gonna put him S tier. Shenryu, by the way, is it's a mage, and he kind of like spaces a lot, and he drops AoE a lot. His EX abilities are all useful, and yeah, that's Shenryu. So I'm just gonna put him S tier since he's not like his photo is not here. But he's a really, really strong character. Now have Eva. Eva is a ranged character. She's the granny of Batarite. She got a lot of slows and a lot of CC, and she moves around a lot. She's kind of like Croak. You have to like jump in and then jump out when you are playing her. The only problem is that she's a ranged character, and if she gets CC when she jumps in, it's really unlikely that she's gonna come back out alive, because most people don't like ranged characters, and it's gonna be really easy to assassinate her. Anyway, she got a shield though, so you can like protect yourself. A really good Eva is really decent at like bringing chaos to the floor. She can really bring chaos. Like when I say chaos, I mean like she can jump in, like destroy your ally, jump back out, and then you trying to like get onto her, and then her allies start to do so much damage to your ally, and you guys cannot move because you got oil on your skin, and it's really crazy. And she got movement speed too. She got this stun-like ability that when it hits one person, it kind of like bounces off to other people. That right is really strong. I really recommend it. And her ultimate is just, it's a machine gun, bro. She can just let loose, like it's crazy. So I think Eva is in the A tier. Like not a lot of people know how to play Eva, but if you know how to play her, you can really carry. And I haven't seen a lot of Eva players. Actually, I'm just gonna drop her in B because I haven't seen a lot of Eva players. Actually, I haven't seen Eva players. And yeah. Anyways, what else? We have Jade. Jade is an S tier. She's the default character that you get as soon as you enter the game. Everybody knows how to play her pretty much. She's not that hard. Her damage output is insane. You can position yourself anywhere on the map with Jade and be okay. She got stealth, she got heals, even though the heal is not like back to back. She got jump, she got like a lot of things that can allow her to live and move around the map without being noticed and stuff like that. And she is really, really strong. She can bring chaos, very similar to Eva. But if she get trapped out, like she just needs stealth or EX to get her way out of there. She's a really strong character. Her burst combo is really insane. Croak and Jay usually go hand in hand. And then here we have Jamila. I've been seeing a lot of Jamila player. Jamila is it's a melee character. I don't really think she's that strong. Jamila can get cut really easily, and she can just get destroyed. I've seen her like in a esport, and a lot of the time people can just bait her counter and stuff and just pull her away and just kill her. I don't think Jamila is that strong, honestly. Jamila against ranged characters is really a one-sided fight, honestly, because she gotta use her little escape to like get closer to the enemy, and before she do that, like the enemy already got something waiting for her. Also, you are not invulnerable when you are like dashing around and stuff like that. Like you are not invulnerable with the hook thing. However, she's really fun to play, and I've seen a lot of Jamila player. So I'm gonna put her in B tier. Jumong is a ranged character. I won't recommend Jumong for anybody because Jumong is just really hard to play. He's not like Jade where like you can mess up and get away with it. Jumong, if you mess up, that's it. That like there's no other way to get out. He's kind of like Yzmo. I have seen some Jumong players. However, it's really hard to team up with a Jumong player and be aggressive at the same time because Jumong is that character that kind of like he's a team dependent laid back type of character. You have to play him like defensively on start and then go offensively later. He can steal orb quite easily with his rain of arrow and like couple of shots. However, I won't recommend him because he's not that easy. And I've seen a lot of people try to play Jumong, but usually fail and it fail horribly. And Jumong usually loses all his matches. Anytime you get Jumong on your team, there's a high percent chance that you will lose. So I'm gonna put Jumong in D tier as trash. We have Lucy. Lucy is a range healer. She got barrier. She don't have that much escapes, honestly. She only got her space and she got that shield thing. The shield you have to save it for your allies, and you have to play her as a ranged DPS. To get like the full damage out of her. She got insane amount of damage, and insane amount of control. However, her escape is quite low. Like if people jump onto Lucy and if they focus her, it's really easy for her to die. If you don't have strong allies, a lot of these characters are team dependent, but Lucy is one of the hardest healers to play because she's very team dependent. So you gotta be able to like protect your Lucy. However, if you can protect her, she can do insane amount of damage. Just because she's really hard to learn, I'm gonna put her in B tier, but Lucy is easily an S tier character. However, it's just really hard to play her, and I don't see a lot of Lucy, so she's gonna be in B tier. We have your boy Uder. Uder is a healer. He's a ranged DPS. She's not really a healer in my opinion. I think Uder is more of a DPS comp type of character because he got insane amount of CC that can set up decent burst combos. If you want to play Uder, you should let your team pick stuff that will survive on their own, stuff like Croak, stuff like Jade. And things that can just peel for you really fast. Stuff like Alessia, people that can peel for you really fast when you need it. And also they can also live on their own without depending on you because you are not really gonna be healing. You're gonna be doing damage, right? I think that's Uder strongest point. So a lot of people take Uder thinking that they're gonna heal and just get away with it. Uder heal is a heal over time. So, if you put it on people like Croak, they can like use that to sustain themselves. However, you can just put your heals on anybody else and like get benefit out of it because like it's really hard to play Uder. That's what I'm trying to say. Because of that, I'm gonna put Uder in D tier because Uder usually loses his matches just because people don't understand him. I'm gonna put him in C tier actually. I've seen a lot of Uder. I haven't seen Jumong. Actually, I've seen a lot of Jumong, but most of them are garbage. And I've lost a lot of matches due to people taking Jumong on my team. And I've won a lot of matches against Jumong players because it's just so easy to beat his team. just because he's so passive. Like, the people who are playing him still don't know how to play him. Alright, Uther on the other hand though, like, it's not that hard to play Uther. However, he's more of a DPS than a healer, which means he goes against his role. He's supposed to be a healer, but he's not really. So we have Pearl here. Pearl is it's an S tier character. Pearl is not that hard to learn. When I'm ranking this character, I'm thinking about how hard is it to pick this character up and learn them. And if you learn them, will you get enough value off of them? Will you be able to climb to them to at least a champion or diamond or something like that, and easily climb pretty much to those tiers, right? Even if like you are not like the super best or whatever, like Pearl is one of those characters that you can just pick up and like learn like in like 1 or 2 days, right? Pearl is not that hard. She don't really get that much pressure in PvPs because a lot of people don't want to touch her, like Freya, because she got a counter, and also she's a midget, so nobody want to touch the lollies before FBI show up. Anyways, Pearl is a really cute healer, very very strong, and she got EX. Her EX is, I think her EX is the strongest of all the healers in the game. Because she can like silence an entire team doing insane burst damage at the same time, and her damage is like both of her EX are DPS stuff, so you get CC and DPS at the same time, so it's really hard to kill her. She get insane heals, AoE heals, and she just does a roll and also do DPS at the same time. So Pearl is like better. She does everything better than Uther. Like, Uther is like attempting to become Pearl, but he's not there yet. So that's why Pearl is the best, and she's gonna be in the S tier. We have Pestilus. Pestilus is a very, very easy character to play. Pestilus is gonna be S tier because a lot of Pestilus usually win their matches, and I've seen Pestilus a lot, especially in esport. And I've seen people use Pestilus to his full potential. And the CC from this guy is insane. The heals from him is insane. The debuff is insane. His ultimate is nasty. Pestilus is really, really strong. As long as you're not taking stuff that would damage you when you heal your ally. Because some Pestilus can just kill themselves without even knowing it. Right? You gotta read his rights and stuff like that. And you gotta learn how to play him, but it's not that hard to pick up. And when you pick him up, you can get insane value from him all the way to GC. So Pestilus is gonna be S tier. Paloma is a really hard character to play. She's really fun. Anyways, Paloma is S tier when it comes to fun because she's got like all of that stylish stuff that you can do if you play her. However, a lot of Paloma players are full of themselves, and instead of healing their allies, they will just jump in trying to become Uther, trying to do a lot of damage. Whereas Paloma is a very team dependent character, and in higher elo, people will see through you and they will wait for you to jump into them. They'll wait for your counter, they'll bait it out, and then they will kill you. So I won't recommend learning Paloma because she's not that easy to play. And also, if she's healing you, people can just stop the heals from coming your way by getting between you and her ally. So, I mean, in between you and her, right? So, I won't recommend Paloma to anyone who's new to the game. Also, to veteran players, I really won't recommend Paloma because she's just that hard. Like, you can get value out of any other character other than Paloma. So, I'm gonna put Paloma in B tier. Paloma is better than Uther because Paloma, at least she can heal, right? Her heal is kind of like instant, right? And she can help her allies escape and stuff like that. She got a lot of escape than in comparison to Uther. So that's that. Right, now we have Rheagon. Rheagon, I've seen a lot of Rheagon's players. If you don't know, if you don't int, like if you don't run it down, It's really easy to play Rengar and win your matches. A lot of people are claiming really fast by picking Rengar because he can sustain himself like 1v2, 1v3. He's really strong. I'm gonna put him in the. I'm gonna put Rengar in I wanna put him in S tier. Rengar is really strong. Like sometimes like noobs can actually run your ass now if you don't play properly because Rengar is just by himself, he's just a very strong character. In team plays in threes, Rengar can do pretty well. He plays like a tank pretty much with his EX M0. He can heal himself, he can just fight. His red space is nasty. I recommend the red space. Yeah, Rengar is a very strong character. He got in caps as well, he got stuns, and he got almost everything. If you mess up with Rengar, like all you have to do is EX, bro. Like anything you mess up with Rengar, just EX your way out of it. Rook is I've seen a lot of Rooks in ranked games. However, actually, I won't say Rooks are bad. Like even noobs can actually school people on Rooks. I say Rook is the ideal team game character for like ranked games because he just brings so much pressure into the game. And if Rook is chasing you down, it's like really hard to get away from him with him like throwing his rocks and like snaring you and stuff. And he got a debuff with the armor break that when he breaks your armor, it increased the amount of damage that you take. And also if any other ally have that same debuff type of thing, Rook and Varish, for example, that's a nice combo. And like if anybody else has the debuff thing, it's really easy to like burst one target down. So I'll recommend Rook to players, but I think Rook is a bit difficult to learn because he got like one escape and then he got one of he got one getaway free card. I don't really think it's a getaway free card because unless you take the right that gave you movement speed, if people hitting your counter really doesn't mean you're gonna live because they can still do damage to you and stuff like that. So you gotta have to like you really gotta build him properly to get value out of him. I'm gonna put Rook in A tier because I've seen a lot of Rook players. However, it's a hit or miss type of thing with Rook. Like some people really know how to play Rook, other people don't. And no matter how hard they try, unless they know how to play melee character in position properly, they won't be able to be successful at Rook. So then we have Rakan. Rakan is a melee character, a hybrid. He's a melee range hybrid. He's a mid-range character. What I mean is his abilities are usually range, but he can also do damage in melee. Like he's a melee character with like range abilities and shit, so he's a mid-range character. It's kind of hard to explain because he's not that easy to play in the first place. Rakan got shield. His shield doesn't last that long though. I mean, Rakan is a strong character, don't get me wrong, but not a lot of people know how to play him. And I've seen a lot of good Rakan in ranked games. I've seen a lot of Rakan wannabes, but I've been seeing decent Rakan players. I'm gonna put Rakan in C tier because even though Rakan is garbage, I mean Rakan players are usually garbage. It doesn't mean that if you learn him you can 1v2 or 1v3. Rakan got some sustains. He got that shield thing that can negate damage. And he's a pretty cool character. He got a lot of escapes. I think he got like three escapes. His arrow, his space, and his shield. So that's good enough for me. Like, however, Rakan is gonna go in C tier because not a lot of people know how to play him. And most of the time Rakan teams usually lose because Rakan players are really easy to get stunned. They are easy to get baited out and then killed. So I won't recommend them. Vortex, I think this is the Vortex. At anything I'll ever get to this point where I have to like actually tier list the Vortex. However, I think the Vortex is I think the Vortex is S tier. The Vortex is a team dependent entity. If you're gonna call it a bane or whatever. The Vortex, you can push people into it and it can just melt them down. The Vortex is it's an end all be all type of character. It got a sustain, it got range DPS if you think about it. It's also melee, it can do damage, and it got some decent shielding for itself. It's really hard to do damage to the Vortex. When the Vortex does damage to you, it's like looking into the abyss. The abyss look back at you and look back right into your soul and stuff like that. I think the Vortex is it's a very very decent thing. It helps finish match really fast. And yeah, I haven't seen anyone 1v1 the Vortex and actually live. I mean, there are a couple of people who can do that. Like, you need to have decent amount of heals to like survive the round. But the Vortex usually come up on top. So I would say the Vortex is an S tier. Too bad nobody can play it though. But you can know if you learn how to play with the Vortex and you learn how to wait for the Vortex and like sustain yourself and stuff like that, the Vortex can work in your favor. So I'll recommend that for S tier. We have Shifu though. Shifu is a melee character. Shifu got some decent amount of sustain. He got some range attacks. It's actually his escape thing, but his melee range is not that far. So Shifu is a bit of a difficult. Shifu is a bit of a difficult character. You gotta know how to position. You gotta keep track of your cooldowns because sometimes Shifu players get carried away. They will chase one person all the way into their spawn and they won't return until they get killed. So if you're playing Shifu, you should keep track of your cooldowns and all that stuff. I won't recommend Shifu to new players because there are just so many ways he can get killed. Even with his own counter that is supposed to like be his strength. People can, if you know how to play, you can actually bait that out and like kill them. So I won't recommend Shifu because it's not that easy to play him. Shifu is not like a tank character. He's not good with like, he's not like a team player, honestly. Like Shifu is like a solo type of guy. Like you gotta get in there, you gotta pressure. And you gotta keep pressuring and just try to live like Freya, pretty much. I would say Shifu is a B tier. He's a hit or miss type of character. You either know how to play him or you don't. And I haven't seen a lot of decent Shifu player yet, so I'm gonna put him in B tier, just because he's not that easy to play. I haven't seen him a lot in ranked games, and I won't recommend him to like new players and stuff like that. And also, if you mess up, it's not that easy to get. Actually, it is a bit easy to get out, like if you have your cooldowns and shit. However, a lot of Shifu players just get carried away. Like it's really easy for them to like go in and never come back out. So that's Shifu for you guys. Also, if your allies are being attacked, it's really hard for you to like defend them, because Shifu is like an offensive heavy character. And his goal is to get in there and keep attacking and keep aggroing and keep making setups and stuff like that with his R ability. However, Shifu, when it comes to defense, Shifu is not really that good. So he's not a well-rounded character. Well-rounded character. So I won't put him in A tier like Rogue. Rogue can smack people away. Actually, Shifu can like stun people too. I mean, Rogue got many ways to like stop people from attacking his allies. Like he can jump up and stare them. He can like throw his rocks. He got way more stuff to do than Shifu, in order to get people away from his allies. So we have Cyrus here. I've seen a shitload of Cyrus in matches. Cyrus like one of the top play, if not actually the top play healer in the game. I've seen him in all elos from like bronze all the way to like diamond and like to GC and stuff like that. Shifu is that character that if you invest a lot of time into, you can really carry your matches. If you're playing healer, right? A lot of healers are like team dependent and they really don't do that much damage. But Sirius, like if you know how to play him and you wait for your weapon charge, you can do insane burst damage to enemies. If you use your weapon charge and then use Aura as well, you can like set up an insane amount of you can you have an insane amount of damage potential as Sirius, right? With your charge weapon. So I'll put him in S tier, because he's that healer that if you mess up, there is a way to get out. You can petrify, you can counter, you can space, and it's I don't know, like Shifu, I mean Sirius is not that hard to play. Just doing spacing on start. Doing spacing and then counter, right? Because that's the Sirius syndrome, like everybody knows that. If you know how to do that, bro, like it's really easy to win your games with Sirius. Like he's not that type of healer that people can just focus down because he got counter, and if you hit his counter, he can get away. He got space, he can space away. He got petrify, he can petrify. If people come close to him, you can hit them and weaken them and reducing the damage that they do to you and stuff like that. So he's a very, very strong, he's a very, very strong character, and it's kind of easy to learn him. So that's that. If you know how to play melee, that is. Teya is a very strong character. She's not stronger than Jade though, in my opinion. Just because of that stealth thing and that snipes. However, if you are going against Teya as a Jade, you really don't want to snipe. You want to EX a lot. You want to M1, I mean M0 her a lot, instead of sniping. However, Teya is really, really fast, and a really decent Teya can like actually stop a melee from like engaging onto their ally, because Teya can really press your back line. If you are playing Teya, you want to be brave though. You want to be really, really fast with your reaction time. Because Freya is vulnerable, she don't have like shields and all that stuff. However, unless she ult, but you get the point, man. She's a very, very fast character, and if you can build her around speed, and like if you know how to like use her boomerang and stuff and like EX a lot, I think Freya is pretty decent. I mean, Teya is pretty decent. However, I would recommend her to new player, and I've been seeing a lot of decent Teya players here. Even though it's like super easy to like win matches with her. I'm gonna put her in B tier. She's not trash, but you can do better with other range characters in my opinion. As in comparison to Teya, and she's not that easy to learn. So that's that. Like in low elos, it's really easy to carry. But in, the higher you go up, it kind of get easier for people to kill you. So I'm gonna put her in B tier. Damn, Teya is broken though. A really decent Teya can really carry. I'm gonna put her in B tier. All right, Torn. Torn is a strong character. He got some insane sustain. The only problem with Torn is engaging. It's really hard to engage to set up the team fight to like start team fights with Torn because he really don't have that much to do. You can try rooting them and then getting close to them, but you can miss your root. And also, like, if you space and go into them, it's really easy for them to focus you and kill you. And I don't know, Torn depends heavily on his energy, and people can like deny that by like forcing him out of the map and out of the match and stuff. So I don't know. I won't recommend Torn to new players. Torns have lost a lot of matches, in my opinion. While they are on my team, and also when I go against Torn, I usually destroy them. So I won't recommend Torn to anybody. In comparison to Rakan, I think I think Thorn is a much lesser character, honest, in my opinion, just because Rakan got that shield and Thorn doesn't. We have your boy Oryk. Oryk is a healer. He actually heals better than Uther, and he got insane amount of mobility, and he got insane stuns. It's not that easy to play Oryk though. I would recommend him to new players. And I see a lot of people picking Oryk because they see him as a healer. He looks cool and stuff like that, and they want to play him. But they usually end up losing their matches because Oryk is not that easy to play. However, if you know how to play him, you can do a lot of decent setup. However, right, if you are going against characters that know how to play their role, right, it's really easy to kill the Oryk. So if you're playing Oryk, you want people who can actually sustain themselves. That really won't depend on you a lot because I think Oryk is it's a combo type of character that can just jump in there, do burst damage, and then jump out. I don't think he's like a healing type of character, because I mean you just get a lot more value out of setting up bursts than worrying about healing people. Oryk is like serious; you have to like get in there to get dirty. However, unlike Sirius, Oryk doesn't have that much of a escape. He got his space. You can space really far away, but you need your energy for that. So that's Oryk. I'm gonna put him B tier though. We got your boy Varish. Varish is it's a very decent character. It's like people need to learn how to land that M0 with Varish in order to actually be valuable to their team and not worry about cooldowns. A lot of Varish players are cooldown dependent. They just wait until their E show up and then they use it and then they wait again. Varish, if you are using Varish, you need to be able to like jump in the enemy and do damage like Teya. Varish is like Varish is a very tanky character, honestly. Like, if you build him right, you can use his shields back to back to back, and if people are counter hitting your counter, you can do insane damage. You can get in their back line, even though he's a ranged character. Varish can do a lot of work. Too bad though, I don't see a lot of people playing Varish, and I haven't seen some decent Varish player yet. And he's really. I don't know. I don't think Varus is team dependent, but he's a very burst. He's a very he's really good at setting up burst combo. Varus can debuff enemies and just he's like Rogue too. He can just increase the chance of them dying. I think Varus is a B tier because I don't think a lot of people know how to play him and get enough value out of him. But Varus got insane damage output, and it's just. He's just so much like I think he's underestimated, underrated, right? So I'll just put him here because like not a lot of people play him and not a lot of people are good with him, so he's just gonna be here. Xander, I've seen a lot of Xander players these days. Xander is he's kind of like Paloma. It's a win-lose type of character. I mean, a hit-or-miss type of character. You either know how to play him, or you just pick him because you see somebody that you don't like, and you want to like throw your matches, or you don't want to rank up. You just want to have fun. Xander is a very very fun character. He's an S tier when it comes to fun too. However, I won't recommend him to anybody because. And when push comes to shove, Xander is not a healer. Xander can easily get destroyed if people know how to focus him down. He got a lot of escape though, and he got a lot of ways to like trick the enemies and stuff like that. But he's not like a lot of people play him, but they don't really know how to play him, and he loses a lot of matches because. He cannot land his heals, and he don't have that much heal to like sustain his allies. Varish, when it comes to like, escaping and like setting up burst comp, I think Varish, I mean, I think Xander is really good, but I won't recommend him because he's not that easy to play, and you'll be better off playing other healers. He's not better than Paloma though, so I'm just gonna put him below Paloma. When it comes to difficulty, I think Varish is, I mean, how you call him? Xander is kind of like above tier in comparison to Puloman. Xander, the reason why he's here is his heal is over time too, right? So it's really easy to kill people when Xander is healing them than if Puloman was healing them, for example. So that's one of his difference. Like those are like the simple, smallest things that actually separate these characters from each other. So that's that, guys. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked the video. Leave your comment below and all that stuff. Peace out. Bye bye.